All right, Alexander, let's talk about Attorney General Bill Barr. And I have to admit, I expected more. That would be my first thing that I said. I expected better things. He started out good. He ended the Russiagate hoax very quickly. He stopped with the nonsense of the Mueller investigation and all that ridiculous stuff going on. We got Durham in place, and then that was it. Everything just stopped. And I think that we'll be able to explain to our viewers what happened. At least we have an analysis, and you have a hypothesis, a theory, and I think it's a well-grounded theory as to what happened. But we have a lot of users that always would say, "Don't trust Barr," and he has an interesting history. I was always a little uncomfortable with Barr's relationship to George W. Bush and the way he was involved in the Bush administration. I think you were too. That's always been a red flag that he is an establishment guy. And I don't think it's a secret he's an establishment guy. Then there is that connection, though it hasn't really been too elaborated on, with his father and Epstein. That's another interesting connection that it would be interesting to have someone dig into that a little bit more, if you could, if you even could. I don't even know if there's records that you could dig into that, with his father being the principal at the school where Epstein was first hired. But anyway, all that aside, when Trump put Barr in place, Barr started out really well, and then I'm not even gonna say the wheels came off. The wheels just stopped. And then you had yesterday the statement from Barr, which is making the rounds everywhere, and I'll read it to you. The statement that's caught the most attention, from an interview with the AP, with the Associated Press, where Barr says this: "To date," and I quote, "to date, we have not seen fraud on a scale that could have affected a different outcome in the election." Obviously, he's talking about the US elections, November 3rd elections, and what's going on right now with the Trump legal team and how they're fighting to stop the steal. The mainstream media obviously has latched on to this. They said, "You see, even Barr can't find anything. This has been the cleanest, fairest, most secure election ever." That's the mainstream media. If Barr was saying something else, then the mainstream media would obviously be saying Barr's a stooge of Trump, Barr's in the bag. I mean, you know what they would have done. But now Barr has found favor in the mainstream media with this interview and this comment. So Alexander, there's a lot to get to. There's some news on Durham as well, but I think the crux of this video and this analysis is, part one, that Barr has turned on Trump. Part two is that this was probably well planned, and Barr made some moves with regard to Durham that reveal that this was a planned out move, and this is connected. What he's done with Durham is connected to what's going on with this fraudulent election, and my opinion continues to stand and continues to become confirmed day by day. A large swath of the Republican Party didn't want mail-in ballots questioned or investigated or stopped because they wanted this process to go through, because they wanted Trump out, and they saw the mail-in ballots as a way to get Trump out. That's why there was very little resistance among a majority of Republicans. Not all, but a majority. Alexander.
First of all, I think you're right. I'm about Barr. I mean, I would add to all the things that you said about, his connection to the Bush family and the fact that he was, Attorney General under George H.W. Bush. I'd add that he also has long-standing connections to the CIA. I mean, he has obviously that kind of very establishment background. He's obviously very much part of the Republican establishment, and I think this explains his moves. But there's no question at all that for at least a year, he's basically stopped working for Donald Trump to any sensible extent. As you absolutely rightly say, he came in, he stopped Mueller, which was a investigation that had gone completely AWOL, as we say in England, absent without leave. It was running all over the place. It was, in fact, if you prefer, a rogue investigation. It started out as an investigation of collusion. It couldn't find evidence of collusion between the Trump campaign and Russia, so it started investigating obstruction instead. And of course, obstruction when there was no underlying crime. I mean, it was a ludicrous investigation, and Mueller did put a stop to that. But I think the Republican Party wanted to see it stopped by that point, because it was affecting the Republicans and had been used by the Democrats in the 2018 elections, the midterm elections, which of course gave the Democrats control of the House of Representatives. So the Republican Party itself was losing ground in part because of Russiagate. So I think, you know, the Republican Party, as well as Donald Trump, had an interest in bringing the Mueller investigation, to an end. And he very quickly and effectively did that. Then he appointed Durham, the U.S. attorney for Connecticut, to investigate, the malpractice and the evidence of malpractice over the course of the various surveillance of the Trump campaign, the various FBI investigations of the Trump campaign, is enormous and growing all the time. So he appointed Durham to investigate all those things. And then everything stopped. And that happened in 2019. I mean, we've heard virtually nothing from Barr ever since then. We heard nothing about him when, as I said, this whole idea of introducing mail-in ballots came in. I mean, you know, he was the Attorney General of the United States. He gave an interview saying that he was concerned about it. He thought that this was, you know, susceptible for fraud and was insecure. But in fact, he did absolutely nothing. He let it happen. I mean, well, he didn't let it happen, but he could have taken steps that might have raised issues about it and attempted to prevent it. He could have, for example, brought proceedings in various courts up and down the United States when the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania appeared to extend the electoral law, change the electoral law in Pennsylvania to allow mail-in ballots to be counted even if they'd come long after election day, which appears to be unconstitutional against Pennsylvania's own constitution. Where was Barr? Did he take any action? Did he support any steps in that respect? No, he didn't. I mean, he could say, well, this isn't really my concern because this is an internal Pennsylvania problem. But of course, as Attorney General of the United States, the country's principal law officer, if he'd wanted to take action, he could have done. He didn't. He let it all slide. And the result is that he's now set up the situation where he's come along on the eve of Donald Trump's lawyers bringing cases to the Supreme Court of the United States, which has always been their objective. He comes along, he says the Justice Department and the FBI have conducted investigations, and they've produced no evidence. They haven't produced the evidence that the entire election result was affected by fraud. That, you know, what fraud did take place was not sufficient to affect the election outcome. Now, can we just unpack that statement before we go further? Because it's actually a pretty remarkable statement. Because if you think about it, what Barr is saying is that there was fraud. He's just saying that there was fraud, but it wasn't enough to change the election outcome. If there was election fraud, that is a felony. He is supposed to be the Attorney General of the United States. He is supposed to be the country's principal law officer. He is in charge of the massive investigative machinery of the United States. He says, well, there's fraud. I'm not going to investigate it because, as far as I'm concerned, I'm not going to prosecute it, rather, because as far as I'm concerned, it didn't affect the election outcome. What has the election outcome got to do with him? That's not his decision to worry about. He ought to be, I would have thought, flagging up the fact that there is actually fraud there. Because that's, if you unpack his statement, what he has said. But he says, you know, even though I have evidence of crimes, I'm not going to pursue them because they didn't have a political outcome. A very remarkable comment, actually, when you sit back and think about it. But what it's going to do is it's going to make it extremely difficult, I think all but impossible, actually, for the Trump campaign team, the Trump legal team, to win a case in the Supreme Court of the United States, because we know how evenly balanced the Supreme Court is, even with Amy Coney Barrett, now a justice. There's Roberts and Kavanaugh, who've often sided now with the liberals in the court. And it seems to me that now that they've been told publicly by the Attorney General of the United States that there is actually insufficient evidence that the fraud that happened was enough to change the outcome of the election, they're going to say, well, in that case, we're not going to interfere with this. I think what Barr has done, and it was done, I think, very intentionally, just on the eve of Supreme Court challenges, on the eve of the case going to the Supreme Court, was intended to shift the balance away from the Trump legal team in the Supreme Court proceedings. And that's what it's going to do. That's what I'm afraid it's going to do. Now, why has this happened? Well, you said right at the outset that Barr, it turns out, is very much of an establishment figure, a Republican establishment figure. We've been discussing in many programs, going back well before the election. In fact, we started saying it most forcefully when we discovered that congressional Republicans found out back in 2017 that the evidence that the Russians actually hacked the DNC was being called into question by Sean Henry of CrowdStrike himself and did nothing. They found out that critical piece of information and did nothing then. We've been saying for a long time that the Republican Party establishment doesn't really want Donald Trump there. I think it's become increasingly obvious over the last few weeks, as they've shown, frankly, no real support for him in all his various court challenges, in all the various steps that have been taken up and down the United States, you know, to force recounts, to, you know, look again at what has been happening in the election. And in fact, the establishment, Republican establishment media centers like the Washington Examiner and the National Review have been piling on the pressure upon Trump to get him to concede. So it seems to me that Barr is fully up with that agenda. He too wants to see Trump concede. But what he also wants is to put the Republicans, this is the Republican establishment, in a strong position come 2022. And that's why he's now appointed John Durham, who has been carrying on an investigation for more than a year, which has produced one minor indictment, but nothing much more than a year, and he's appointed him special counsel.
You're referring to Clyde Smith.
I'm referring to the Clyde Smith case. He's appointed him special counsel. But look at the way in which Barr did that. He appointed Durham special counsel on the 19th of October, before the election. He apparently didn't tell Donald Trump. He didn't formally inform the congressional leaders. He didn't inform Congress, though I'm sure congressional Republicans knew all about it. But he didn't let either the country or the president know that this massively important step had been taken. And that was clearly done so that Trump could gain no benefit from it in the run-up to the election. Now, I've got the letter of appointment of Durham in front of me, and what it says, and I'll read it very briefly. The special counsel is authorized to investigate whether any federal official, employee, or any other person or entity violated the law in connection with the intelligence, counterintelligence, or law enforcement activities directed at the 2016 presidential campaigns, individuals associated with those campaigns, and individuals associated with the administration of President Donald J. Trump, including but not limited to Crossfire Hurricane and the investigation of Special Counsel Robert S. Mueller III. If the Special Counsel believes it is necessary and appropriate, the Special Counsel is authorized to prosecute federal crimes arising from his investigation of these matters. So notice that the Mueller investigation, the Mueller team themselves, are now part of that investigation. So Durham is able to look at and go over all the things that the Mueller team did. And if he finds that they acted against the law, he's entitled to bring prosecutions against them. So I think this is the Republican tactic. They didn't want Durham to do anything whilst Donald Trump was president, because they didn't want anything to happen that might actually help Donald Trump's re-election. They appointed Durham special counsel in this hole in the corner way to make it difficult, as they believe, for Biden to sack him. And what they're now going to do is they're going to do a reverse Mueller, just as Mueller was used to destabilize Trump. They're now going to try and use Durham to destabilize Biden, because, of course, Biden was vice president of the United States during this period, which Durham is investigating. He was an elected official. He was party to several of the decisions that led up to Russiagate and involved Russiagate. So you can set Durham loose to investigate him and all the others. You can use Durham to bring indictments and prosecutions. You can destabilize Biden. You can then, hopefully, if you're a Republican, use that to set the stage for a Republican landslide in 2022. And perhaps, if you really want to press it, you can go further and bring impeachment proceedings later. So you've got rid of Donald Trump. You've done absolutely nothing to help Donald Trump. You've been absolutely silent. You've spiked his case in the Supreme Court. But at the same time, you set this bomb under Biden by appointing Durham special counsel. I don't think it's going to work. I don't think Biden is going to respect this decision. I know that in theory, it is more difficult to sack a special counsel. But if Biden sacks Durham, he will have the support of the Democrats, and he will have the support of the media. And of course, he will have the support of, you know, people like Comey and Clapper and Brennan and all the others. So I think he will simply do it. And like all overcomplicated and over clever strategies, it will fail, and it will have failed whilst at the same time having spiked the guns, if you like, of a Republican president trying to bring his case to the Supreme Court of the United States. So it's an over-clever strategy, a cold-blooded and ruthless strategy. Trump is bound to see this as a betrayal, and it is probably going to fail anyway.
Yeah, this is the worst betrayal you could possibly have. Man, politics is just dirty, cutthroat. A couple of things, and you can comment on these three, four points. The first point is that we do have some Republicans that are still backing Trump in the Senate, most notably Rand Paul, who has come out with a statement that he thinks there are sufficient statistical and mathematical anomalies that need to be investigated. Rand Paul has tweeted that much. Ted Cruz yesterday did pen a letter to the Supreme Court where he is urging them to take up the case based on constitutional grounds, because the case that we've made many times that the Pennsylvania Supreme Court should not have made the mail-in ballot laws. That should be left to the legislature. So thus, you have a constitutional grounds to see the case. So Ted Cruz did pen a very strong letter urging the Supreme Court to look at that specific case. So, okay, you have Rand Paul, You have Ted Cruz. We did say at the beginning, most of the Republicans, but not all. So you do still have some Republicans that have, it looks like they have Trump's back. First point. Second point, we always have to remember, and you brought it up, the Republicans, they knew the Steele dossier was bogus, but they still went on with the charade that Mueller's a man of integrity and don't fire him, Trump, or else we're going to impeach you because we have to hear from Mueller. So we knew back then that people like Lindsey Graham, who was saying that stuff, were already targeting Trump. Look at their actions. They knew the Steele dossier was a hoax. You can get into that, but they didn't say anything. And they let the whole charade run all the way through up till where we got to see Mueller testify, which was just an utter laughable disgrace. That's the first thing. Another thing, looking at their actions, if the Republicans really wanted to put pressure on governors, Republican governors like Kemp in Georgia or Ducey in Arizona, they would have, but they didn't. They've remained completely silent. I think that's what's led to Kemp and Ducey to sign off on the election results because they probably have an order from the Republicans to sign off on it. I don't think these guys are rogue. I think these guys are actually in lockstep with the Republican establishment, the McConnells and the Lindsey Grahams, and they're saying, yes, we will sign off on these election results because we're going to do as you guys in DC tell us to do, where they could have put pressure on them. And finally, to wrap it up, so we wrap up this video and let me condense what's going on here. Basically, the Republicans, they use Trump on the campaign trail to create a red wave, win the House, win as much of the Senate as they can. They used Trump. They got the support they needed. They're in a strong position now. They dispose of Trump. They had this in the plans way back by not allowing any of the Durham stuff to go through or to be announced. Dispose of Trump afterwards with the mail-in ballots. They were in it with the Democrats. We're not going to stop mail-in ballots because this is our way to finally be rid of Orange Man. This is how we're going to get rid of him. Both Democrats and Republicans were saying this. They let that go through. So they use Trump. Then they dispose of him and they're not supporting him with this steal. I bet you they're pretty taken aback by how much of a fighter Trump is, on a side note, that Trump is really fighting this that hard. I bet you they were thinking he would just concede and that would be it. And finally, they're looking to use now this Durham special counsel going forward to go after Biden, or maybe even Harris, if Biden even makes it through a year, to go after Biden or Harris. 2020, they're going to come up with another red wave and take the House. And then they're going to launch, most likely, an establishment Republican candidate to take the White House in 2024. And in their mind, the deception becomes complete.
Absolutely. I think you've described the situation exactly right. I think the ideal Republican solution is they get back control of Congress and they have a Jeb Bush style establishment Republican in the White House in 2024. They were never happy, most of them, with Donald Trump. You're absolutely right. There are some Republicans who think otherwise. There's people like Rand Paul, there's people like Ted Cruz. There's many more, I think, in the House. I've always got the impression, right from the start, that Donald Trump had much more support amongst Republicans in the House of Representatives. And the House Minority Leader, the new one, who fought the campaign and won so many seats, was successful in winning so many seats for the Republicans in the House elections that have happened as part of the general election that took place on the 3rd of November, not just the presidential election, but the House elections then. He's actually spoken very warmly about Donald Trump and has said what a critically important role Donald Trump played in helping Republicans win seats from the Democrats up and down the country. He's confirmed that he was in telephone contact with Donald Trump all the time, and that they were coordinating their campaigns, and that Trump was unstinting in his support for House Republican candidates and was absolutely central to the Republicans winning back so much of the House. So, Trump does have support amongst some Republicans in the Senate. He has more support amongst Republicans in the House, but the old guard Republican establishment, the Mitch McConnells and the Paul Ryans, and Paul Ryan, by the way, hasn't completely gone away, and he's one of the people who's also said that Trump should concede. They've never liked him. As far as they're concerned, he is not one of, you know, that the patrician group that, you know, they belong to. They've never felt comfortable with him. They've always seen him as an outsider. And they used him. They've used him in this election. And now they want to throw him away like a used glove. And you're absolutely right. They didn't expect that he would fight in the way that he has. And they're getting increasingly exasperated because they are he is fighting in the way that he has. You only have to read what people like Jim Geraghty in National Review, who's very close to the Republican establishment, are saying about Trump to see that they're saying that, you know, Trump is behaving appallingly. I mean, you know, quite astonishing. And yes, it's very important that Ted Cruz is writing to the Supreme Court of the United States. Ted Cruz is himself a brilliant lawyer, somebody who is fully qualified one day, if he wants to become a Republican pick for a Supreme Court justice. I mean, you know, there are issues of Ted Cruz's politics, which I'm uncomfortable with, but about his abilities as a lawyer and as a jurist, I have never questioned them. And so it's very, you know, right and proper that Ted Cruz should be raising these legal and constitutional questions. But I come back to what I said. At the end of the day, when the Supreme Court sees that the Attorney General of the United States, no less, says, well, you know, what fraud did take place, didn't affect the election, you know, the more weak-minded amongst the Supreme Court justices, let's be very clear, there's probably a majority, will say to themselves, do I really want to bring on myself all the trouble of actually taking steps that might, you know, that might put this election in jeopardy and might cause me an enormous amount of trouble in the process, an enormous amount of trouble in and abuse in the process? And Barr knows that. And Barr, who is, as I said, a law officer, has in effect meddled in the political process by admitting that that fraud happened, but say, in effect, I'm not bothered with it, even though fraud on this scale is a serious federal felony. I'm not bothered with it. I'm not going to prosecute it. I'm not going to really investigate it because, as far as I'm concerned, it didn't really matter because it didn't affect the outcome. How does Barr know that? How is Barr in a position to be able to say whether it affected the outcome or not? I don't know, because, of course, the reality is that, as far as we can tell, there's been very little investigation indeed. But that's what Barr has done. That's the strategy. I think you've described it exactly. They're going to try to weaponize Durham. The Republicans, the Republican establishment is going to try to weaponize Durham against Biden in the same way that the Democrats weaponized Mueller and Wiseman against Trump. I don't think it's going to work. I think, as I said, we will see fairly early on in the Biden administration, Durham shown the door and sacked. And I think that all overcomplicated strategies, it's not going to work. And I get to say something else. I'm not absolutely convinced there is going to be this red wave that the Republicans are assuming there's going to be in 2022. Because I was reading again in the Washington Examiner, you know, rather, you know, chortling, happy article about how the Republicans are going to win seats because they're going to be able to control, you know, the redistricting in various states, and California is going to lose House seats, and that's going to tilt the balance back towards the Republicans. But, you know, if you have mail-in ballots in 2022 on the scale that you had in 2020, and you've let what happened in 2020 pass, how do you know the same thing won't be done to you in 2022? I wouldn't predict, I wouldn't be comfortable with this, but apparently some people in the Republican Party are. They dislike Donald Trump so much, and I think it's clear they do, that for them, getting rid of him is almost as big as a priority for them as it is for the Democrats.
Yeah, I mean, anything can happen from now up until 2022. God knows what's happened this year has been completely unpredictable. But I think this revelation explains a lot, and it may even explain more than we think, actually. And I'll get to this point. One, I think it explains why we were pulling our hair for the past 6 months, saying, God, there's so much evidence as to what happened in Russiagate, you know, Brennan handwritten notes and what Sidney Powell exposed and, you know, what the Flynn case exposed, the text messages from Strzok and Lisa Page and FBI agents taking insurance policies. I mean, we actually have the documentation in front of us, and we're pulling our hair saying, why haven't they done anything? I mean, you know, a 5-year-old can expose what's happened here, can come up with indictments. So I think this explains why they didn't do anything, even though the evidence is clear as day. I mean, for the whole world to see as to what was going on with Russiagate. I think this also explains why the FBI did nothing about the Hunter laptop. The FBI falls under the DOJ. And once again, I think there was an order which was saying, look, take that laptop, hold it for a year, don't do anything, because once again, we don't want anything getting in the way of our efforts to get Trump out of the White House. We don't want any negative on Biden and any positive on Trump. So I think that might have been an order that probably was an order from the Republican elite and the Democrat elite to the DOJ, to Barr, then to the FBI, saying, take the laptop, sit on it. Number two, I think this may also explain a lot, my final two things. This may explain a lot as to why there was never a push to deal with big tech, even though I think Trump made a lot of mistakes there as well. But the only way he could have acted was via executive order. But I think that the Senate didn't deal with big tech in a way that they should have, even though we knew the censorship that they were doing, and we knew what they were up to, and the monopolistic practices and the cartel practices. So that explains a lot why nothing was done for big tech. And finally, and maybe this is a stretch, maybe not, I think this explains Fox News. I think this explains the turn of Fox News, in that the Republican elite told the Fox, you know, top execs, the Murdochs of these guys, this is the game plan. And Fox said, gotcha, we understand.
I don't think it's a stretch at all. I think it's exactly right. I'm going to be very fair to Barr, and I'm going to just read out his own explanation, which he's provided in a letter to Congress for why Durham hasn't taken action. And he says on May 13th, 2019. So, you know, bear in mind, we are, you know, a year and three quarters now, or year and a half from his appointment. I directed John Durham, US for the district, US Attorney for the District of Connecticut, to investigate certain intelligence and law enforcement activities surrounding the 2016 presidential election. Although I had expected Mr. Durham to complete his work by the summer of 2020, the pandemic, as well as additional information he uncovered, prevented him from doing so. So, this pandemic serves so many useful purposes. It's now the reason that Durham wasn't able to complete his investigation by the summer of 2020. Well, of course, if you believe that, I have a bridge to sell you. Because, I mean, as you rightly say, how much evidence do you need? I mean, you don't need to have every piece of evidence in your possession. You know, before you bring indictments, you have to have sufficient evidence in your hand to bring indictments. And if you tell me that evidence isn't there, well, frankly, I mean, I'm just incredulous And the suggestion, which I read in some places, that, you know, you can't bring grand juries together. I mean, that is absurd. That would mean that the entire criminal justice system of the United States has ground to a stop, when self-evidently that isn't true. So, you know, clearly there was no real drive to bring this thing together, to bring the Durham investigation together before the election. And the reason that was done was to help Donald Trump, not to help Donald Trump, to make it more difficult for Donald Trump going into the election. And you're quite right, they did nothing about the big tech companies. There was a meeting, by the way, between various people from the Republican leadership and, you know, their friends. And people like Zuckerberg back in the summer, I remember it, and apparently some kind of gentleman's agreement was reached. I mean, there was actual talk about that. I read all about it in the Washington Examiner. Byron York was in on that meeting, and he's, you know, their lead political correspondent. And yet we saw that during the actual election, the big tech was as aggressively hostile to Donald Trump as it has ever been. In fact, it was far more aggressively hostile to Donald Trump than it has ever been. So if there was a gentleman's agreement between the Republicans and big tech at that meeting, it clearly didn't extend to Donald Trump. And of course, as you absolutely rightly say, Fox News changed. I mean, there's a few people still left on Fox News who are keepers of the Trump flame, but the channel overall has now switched and has taken a much more anti-Trump position. So I think that you would have to be blind not to see what has happened if you actually consider the facts which are out there.
Yeah, all right. Et tu, Brutus? Et tu? Is that the phrase?
Et tu, Brute? Absolutely. And yeah, you too, Brutus. Well, there you go. So, I mean, you know, I don't know whether Trump does much classical reading, but perhaps he does. I mean, and it's perhaps not inappropriate, because Trump actually does fill many of the criteria of a classical hero. You know, the person who wins every battle, the mighty warrior, who is brought down by a stab in the back. We will see whether there is a Mark Antony coming to follow him and avenge him. Perhaps he will be his own Mark Antony. We shall see.
All right, we'll leave it there. Alexander Barakuris, thank you very much. Guys, like this video, click on the subscribe button down below. Give us a thumbs up. Give us one of these. Give us a thumbs up. We really need it. And also, please make sure you're still subscribed to the channel, because YouTube is removing a lot of subscribers. And share this video, guys. Get this video out there. I think this is an important video to share. And get it in front of the Trump war room, or the Steve Bannon war room, or the Dan Bongino war room, or whatever war room is around that is fighting this good fight. And also make sure to donate to us, PayPal, Patreon, and Subscribestar. You'll find those links in the description box down below. We also take Bitcoin as well. You'll find that link as well. BitChute, Odyssey, and Rumble. You'll find those links as well. Join us on those other platforms. Help us grow on those platforms as well. And also the Duran Shop. Pick up some merch. And I've got a new mug right there that you can see. And Alexander has all kinds of new Duran stuff as well.
Oh, absolutely. I've got this amazing... but first of all, may I just show again, because we've been talking about the United States, the mug with the flag of the United States. But can I again reiterate, we have mugs, amazing Duran Magic mugs with the flags of many countries. We also have now mugs like this one, designed by our great friend, the fine Greek artist, Dimitris Oikonomou, which you can also find. And we've got shirts also with his designs on them. And they're exclusive for the Duran, and therefore for our viewers also. And we've got our amazing, we've got sweatshirts and hats also with flags. This one embroidered hat with the flag of the United Kingdom. We've got hoodies. We've got amazing things. And all of our products are of superb quality. The feedback we get from people who buy them from our shop is, you know, rapturous. And can I just say, you support us also by going to the shop. So you get wonderful things from the shop and you support the Duran too. But please also support us in the way that Alex said, by, you know, finding us on our other platforms, BitChute, Library, Rumble, Odyssey, and also support us through, you know, Subscribestar and Patreon, and, you know, by making donations and whatever. Because without your support, we will really struggle, and we're having to fight all the time. It's not easy for us to do what we do. So support us whatever way you can. Remember to buy these great things from our shop, and at the same time, come and follow us in our next broadcast.
Alexander Rikers, thank you very much. Until next time, everybody, take care.